Welcome to Thermodynamics.
Today we are going to discuss a widely misunderstood or misinterpreted topic, and even faculties find difficulties in explaining this topic, and that is nothing but energy analysis of unsteady flow process. Fortunately, I have got an opportunity to learn this topic from the great teacher Praveen Kulkarni sir. So let me present you energy analysis of unsteady flow process. Before going to do the energy analysis of unsteady flow process, we like to understand what is the difference between a steady flow process and an unsteady flow process. Okay, an unsteady flow process is nothing but a process in which inside the control volume the properties may be changing with respect to time. That means if the properties like mass or total energy is changing with respect to time inside the control volume, we can say that particular process as an unsteady flow process. If the properties are not changing with respect to time, that process is nothing but a steady flow process. Consider an example of filling of air inside a balloon. Okay. Consider the inside volume of balloon as control volume. Now you are seeing air is being filled inside the control volume, right? That means the property called mass is being changed inside the control volume with respect to time. This is a clear-cut example of an unsteady flow process. Okay? Now I'll make it this clear by giving you another example. Consider a beaker or a barrel. Okay, a big barrel is there and it is connected to a water tap. Okay, and water is coming from the tap. And considering this volume as control volume, this is my control volume. Okay, now I am considering that 10 kilogram per second of water is coming in. That means in each second 10 kilogram of mass is being accumulated inside my control volume. That means the property mass is being increased inside my control volume. So it's an example of an unsteady flow process. Okay, now consider a vent here. Okay, and through vent water is going out. Consider that this is also 10 kilogram per second, right? That means in each second 10 minus 10 kilogram is being accumulated. That means no mass is being accumulated inside the control volume as time changes. So this is an example of a steady flow process, right? Now consider instead of 10 kilogram, 8 kilogram of water is being, 8 kilogram per second of water is being lost from this vent. Okay, is it an example of unsteady flow process or a steady flow process? Yes, it's an example of an unsteady flow process that you can feel, right? 10 minus 8, that is equal to 2 kilogram per second of water is being accumulated inside the control volume. That means mass is changing with respect to time. So this is an example of an unsteady flow process. Now consider 15 kilogram per second of water is being lost from my control volume. That means 10 kilogram per second of water is coming in and 15 kilogram per second of water is going out. Is this an example of unsteady flow process or a steady flow process? First of all, is this process possible? No? Yes? If initially inside my control volume I am having certain amount of mass of water, this is possible, right? Consider that I am having 100 kilogram of water, 100 kilogram of water inside my control volume initially. That means before starting of process I am having 100 kilogram of water, right? And 10 kilogram per second of water is coming in and 15 kilogram per second of water is going out. Okay, now we know that it's possible. And it's clear that 10 minus 15, that means minus 5 kilogram per second of mass is being changed inside. That means in each second 5 kilogram of mass is being reduced from the control volume. So that's also an unsteady flow process, right? The property called mass is changing with respect to time. So that's clear cut example of an unsteady flow process. Now let's see what will be the mass inside the control volume after 5 seconds. Okay, we concluded that each second 5 kilogram of mass is being accumulated. After 5 seconds,
that is equal to 25 kilogram of water is lost through the vent, right?
Total mass interaction that happened is 25 kilogram. So initially it was having 100 kilogram, and after the process or after the experiment, it will be having 100 minus 25 kilogram, that is equal to 75 kilogram. Right?
So here certain quantity of mass is coming in, certain quantity of mass is going out per unit rate, and inside the control volume certain kilogram of mass was there, and after that process certain kilogram of mass is there. Right?
Now we are in a position to do the energy analysis of unsteady flow process. Let's do that. Okay, do you understand till now what is an unsteady flow process? Okay, if the properties is changing with respect to time inside the control volume, we'll say that is an unsteady flow process. If a process is said to be unsteady flow process, if its mass inside the control volume is changing with respect to time, or the energy inside, the total energy of the control volume is changing with respect to time, then also we can say this is an unsteady flow process. Okay, now we will do the energy analysis of an unsteady flow process, and we will be getting two weapons. Using that you can solve any problems. I hate to use the word weapon, but still this is a weapon, and you can solve any problem using that two weapons. Okay, are you ready for this? Before doing the energy analysis, we like to follow certain notations. Okay, so through this pipe all the incoming fluid are coming, right? And through this vent all the fluid are going out. And initially, that means before the starting of process, I was having certain quantity of mass inside this control volume, and after the experiment or after the process, I was having some certain quantity of mass inside this control volume, right? So all the incoming properties I'll be denoting with a subscript I, incoming I. So the incoming mass will be I, and incoming enthalpy will be HI, and incoming specific internal energy will be UI. Incoming specific enthalpy is HI. Similarly, outgoing mass is ME, outgoing enthalpy is HE, outgoing in specific internal energy is UE. Okay, you understood this, right? And initially we were having certain quantity of mass inside this control volume. In the last case, we have seen that we were having 100 kilogram of mass inside the control volume, and that we are taking it as M1. What is it? M1. In our example, it was 100 kilogram. Now I am not taking the example, I am just considering everything in a variable form. And after the process, we were having, it is left with some mass, right? And in the last example, we have seen that 75 kilogram of mass was left at the end of process. Okay, so that we are denoting with a subscript or M2. So initially we were having some mass inside the control volume, that is M1, and at the end of process we were having some mass, that is M2. So all the incoming properties are denoted with a subscript I. So I am having MI, HI, UI for mass and specific enthalpy and specific internal energy. Similarly, ME, HE and UE. Okay, now you have to understand one more thing, that is, I said 10 kilogram per second of mass is coming in, and 8 kilogram per second of mass was going in out, right? That means I express the mass in terms of mass flow in terms of unit time. So that is not just a mass, that is a mass expressed in terms of mass flow expressed in terms of unit time, that is nothing but dm by dt, right?
that in our last case it was 10 kilogram per second. It was not just 10 kilogram, it was 10 kilogram per second. So I'll have to write dm by dt. So for simplicity, dmi by dt is denoted as mi dot, and dme by dt is denoted as me dot. So hereafter I'll be following mi dot and me dot. Okay, since this is what important for our analysis, not the just mass term. All the time we'll be expressing mass flow, so that too in mass per unit time. So hereafter I'll be representing mi dot and me dot. Okay, is that clear? Is these notations, that means mi dot hi ui, me dot he ue, and m1 and m2, is these are clear, and we can easily do the energy analysis. At the end of the analysis we'll be getting two equations, and we can call that as weapons. Using these weapons and these notations, we can solve any problems coming from unsteady flow process. So are you ready for this? Let's do this. When I said the first example that 10 kilogram per second of mass was incoming and 8 kilogram per mass was going out, and we knew that 10 minus 8, that is 2 kilogram of mass is being accumulated inside the control volume per second, right? So first of all we will be doing the mass conservation principle on this system, on this control volume, and we will be getting equation, that is our first weapon. So mass conservation principle. So rate of change of mass inside the control volume is equal to incoming minus outgoing. Is there any other mass interaction happening here? Some is coming, some is going, and all the remaining will be accumulated inside, right? So I'll be having dmi by dt minus dme by dt, and we know that this is nothing but mi dot, and this is nothing but, no dot is here, okay, this is nothing but me dot. So I am having the first weapon, that is dm by dt, or rate of change of mass inside the control volume, is equal to mi dot minus me dot, right? Okay, I'll be putting this in a big box. Okay, that means rate of change of mass inside the control volume is the difference of rate of mass incoming and exiting. Is that clear? Now we will do the energy analysis, or we will be applying the conservation of energy principle for this control volume. Okay. Similar to mass, the accumulation of mass inside the control volume, we can do the energy analysis also. We can write the rate of change of mass inside the control volume as rate of incoming mass minus rate of incoming energy minus rate of outgoing energy, right? This much energy will be accumulated or decrease inside the control volume, right? Incoming energy minus outgoing energy, right? that may include work transfer and heat transfer also, right? And we know that the incoming energy is equal to, it will be having, incoming fluid will be having certain quantity of enthalpy, it will be having certain quantity of kinetic energy, it will be having certain quantity of potential energy, and it will be involved some heat transfer also. So I can write MIHI, this is a total enthalpy, plus MGZ1, Z1 is nothing but the elevation, plus it will be having some kinetic energy, that is half MC1 square or CI square plus Q, right? Similarly, for E2, I'll be having MEHE plus MEGZ1 plus half MECE square plus work transfer. So, this will be the energy, incoming energy, and E2 will be the outgoing energy, right? And I like to apply this equation here. So I'll be having dE by dt inside the control volume is equal to d by dt of MIHI plus MIGZ1 plus half MICI square plus Q minus d by dt of MEHE, right? MEHE plus MEGZ plus I'll be having half MEC square plus work transfer, right? To understand this equation, the rate of change of energy inside the control volume is nothing but the difference in incoming energy, rate of incoming energy and rate of outgoing energy or exiting energy. That's what I have written here. Okay, do you understand this? This we like to keep it in a box because this is our mother equation. Okay, here I am having the mother equation. Now we will be applying two assumptions. At the end of applying these two assumptions, we will be getting the weapon. Okay, first assumption is kinetic and potential energy changes are neglected. The changes that is happening in kinetic and potential energy changes is very less comparing to the other changes, so we can neglect them. So here this is my potential energy term, so d by dt of MIGZ at change is neglected. Similarly for kinetic energy, that is also neglected. Here also these two terms are neglected, and here this is nothing but the total stored energy. Total stored energy inside the system is nothing but the sum of kinetic and potential and internal energy. That means the change in total energy is equal to change in kinetic energy plus change in potential energy plus change in internal energy. Just now we are seeing that we are neglecting changes in kinetic and potential energies. So we can neglect this and this, and hereafter D is nothing but DU. Is that clear? Now we are going to apply this change and this change, and we'll be getting an equation. We'll see what it is. Okay. After applying those assumptions, I'll be getting du by dt of control volume is equal to d by dt of mihi plus q minus d by dt of mehe plus work transfer. Right? This is the equation I am getting after applying the first assumption, that is kinetic energy changes and potential energy changes are neglected. Now I am going to apply the second and last assumption in this case, that is we are assuming that enthalpy HI and HE, the incoming fluids enthalpy and outgoing fluids enthalpies, are not changing with respect to time. They are constant with respect to time. That is the assumption we are taking. That means d by dt of HI is nothing but HI is itself. Okay, it's a constant. That is d by dt of HI is HI itself. Okay, so I am applying that and I'll be getting du by dt. The second assumption is enthalpies are not changing with respect to time. So you'll be getting, what is d by dt of mi? D by dt of mi can be represented as mi dot. We already seen that. And d by dt of hi is nothing but hi itself, right? That means hi is a constant. If the d by dt of hi will be zero only, but the term d by dt of mi hi can be represented as hi into d by dt of mi, that is nothing but mi dot. Hi into mi dot plus q dot. Remember, a dot is here. Dq by dt is coming here. For that, I am representing it with a q dot minus. I'm taking this minus throughout, so I'll be getting hc and me dot minus wcv dot. Do you understand this equation? The rate of change of energy inside the controller volume is nothing but this equation. And here also d by dt of me he is nothing but he is coming out as he is constant, and d by dt of me is nothing but me dot, and d by dt of wcv is represented by wcv dot. So this is the second weapon I am giving to you. If you know all the notations and the two weapons or two equations I have just given to you, you can solve any problems that I am going to give you, or even if from any competitive examinations. Okay, do you understand this? Now we will be doing some interesting problems. After that, you can confidently say that you know energy analysis of unsteady flow process. Let's do that. Before solving the numerical problems, let's have familiarization with the various terms, various notations we were used in this analysis. Okay, consider the first case of blowing of air inside or filling of a balloon. Okay, initially it will be having some air inside this balloon. Okay, right? Now I am going to blow. Right? Let's analyze various terms involved in this process. I am having a balloon. Okay? Right? And let's see what are the terms like mi, m1, m2 and me. Okay, these terms we can easily imagine and see what are the things coming in. Okay, so the process of filling the balloon, right? A balloon is here, so I blown air to this balloon, so definitely it will be having some value, right? Mi dot will be there. Similarly, let's take what is the value for m1. Before filling of air, some atmospheric air was inside this balloon, right? That means that much mass of air was already inside this control volume. So m1 value will be, some value will be there. And coming to m2, after filling process its mass is increased, right? So some quantity of mass is there inside this balloon, so m2 will be there. Now consider that last term, that is me or me dot. What is the value of me dot here? Only air is incoming, air is here, nothing is outgoing. Is there any vent through which air is going out? No, it is completely filled here, right? So nothing is outgoing or nothing is exiting from the control volume. So this value is equal to zero, right? Do you understand this? Mi is there, as I am filling the air, some rate of mass is coming into the control volume, so mi dot is there. And initially it was having some mass, so m1 is also there. And finally it is having some mass inside this control volume, so m2 is also there. And coming to me dot, nothing is going out from the control volume, nothing is exiting from the control volume. Me dot is zero. Me dot is zero. Me dot is, yes. Now we will take another example. Okay, before going to that next example, we will see this one itself. Now consider this process, that is releasing of air from this balloon. So can you tell me what are the terms involved in this one? Releasing of air from the balloon. So what is mi dot, me dot, m1 and m2? Can you tell me? Is there any mi dot is there? Is any air is coming into this balloon? I'm talking about the next process, that is releasing of air. Nothing is there, right? Every air is being coming out, so nothing is going in. So mi dot is equal to zero. What is me? Mi dot is zero. So what is mi dot? Air is going out, right? So definitely this value will be there. What is m1? M1 is also there. Some air was there inside the filled balloon, so it is there. Similarly, some air will be left inside this balloon, that is m2 is also there, right? Do you understand? Do you understand how to get the values of mi dot, me dot, m1 and m2? Do you understand? Let's take another example. Okay, this is my control volume. Okay, consider that this is having a valve through which our flow can be controlled, and the main point is this control valve or this control volume or this tank is previously evacuated. What is it? Previously evacuated. So no mass is present inside this control volume, and using this valve I can operate this valve and make sure that some fluid is flowing into the chamber. This is a supply line. If I am opening this valve, some fluid will be going into this chamber or control volume. And it was initially evacuated. Initially evacuated. So let's analyze various terms. Mi dot, me dot, m1 and m2. Can you do it? Can you tell me, is there any mi dot involved? When I open the valve, some air will be coming in, right? So this will be there. What about mi dot? Is there any value? We know that no air is going out of this control volume, right? Is there any vent? Nothing is there, right? So no air, no quantity of air is coming, or no quantity of fluid is coming out of this control volume. So mi dot will be zero. What about m1 and m2? M1 is, can you tell me the value of m1? It was previously evacuated, right? So there is no mass before the starting of process inside the control volume. That is, there is no mass inside the control volume before starting of process, as it is initially evacuated, right? So m1 is zero. What is the value of M2? Definitely there will be some value for M2. As we open the valve, air will be coming or fluid will be coming inside, and when we close this, there will be some mass left inside this control volume. So definitely M2 will be there, right? Okay, now we are in a position to do the problem. An insulated storage tank that is initially evacuated is connected to a supply pipeline carrying an ideal gas at a specific internal energy UI and specific enthalpy HI and temperature TI. The valve is opened and fluid flows into the tank from supply pipeline and reaches the pressure same as that of supply pipeline. Find the final temperature of the gas inside the tank. According to the question, an ideal gas is flowing through this supply pipeline and it is connected to a tank which is previously evacuated and it is fully insulated, and the connection is controlled through a valve. And in the question they say is the supply pipeline is carrying an ideal gas having an internal energy UI, specific internal energy UI and specific enthalpy HI and temperature TI, and this valve is opened, then the fluid will rush into this tank. This tank is previously evacuated, so it will develop some pressure when it opened, and finally both are reached at same pressure, then the flow is finished. And they are asking us to find what is the final temperature of the gas inside this tank. Okay, and from this question we can understand that this is a unsteady flow process, because as the time passes, the property mass is changing with respect to time inside this tank, right? It is just like the case of filling of balloon, as I said in the earlier, right? But there is a difference, that is, it is previously evacuated. In our balloon case, there was some air inside this balloon before starting of process, but in this case there is no air, nothing is there inside the control volume before starting the process. So let's find out what are things they are given. Okay, they are given that UI, TI and HI. This is for incoming fluid, and definitely some MI will be coming, MI dot will be coming, but we don't know the value. Coming back to ME dot, do we have any value for ME dot? Do we have any value for ME dot? No, right? Since there is no vent, no gas will be flowing out of our control volume. This will be our control volume. Since nothing is going out, ME dot will be zero. Now let's come to M1 and M2. Okay, M1 and M2. What is the value of M1 here? M1 is the mass of the gas inside the control volume before starting of process. Since it is a previously evacuated tank, that means there is no mass inside the tank. That means M1 is zero. What about M2? We don't know. Anyway, there will be definite value. Okay, so that's all about the given data, and they are asked us to find final temperature inside this. Let me denote that with T2. Okay, we'll have to find T2. We have two weapons, right? One is conservation of mass principle, according to conservation of mass principle, and other one is conservation of energy equation, right? Do you remember that? Do you remember those equations? First one is dm by dt of control volume is equal to mi dot minus me dot, right? But me dot is zero. Since no gas is flowing out, me dot comes to be zero. So only thing will be dm by dt cv is equal to mi dot. Next, let's apply the next equation, that is next weapon, that is du by dt of control volume is equal to mi dot hi plus q dot minus me dot he
minus WCV dot.
Right? This was the weapon, second weapon I was given to you. And let's see what are things we can strike off. Do you see any work transfer involved in this process? No work transfer, right? Only flow of liquid, flow of gas into this control volume. No work is involved, no expansion work, no shaft work, no electrical work. So work transfer involved is zero. And it is fully insulated tank, right? So there is no heat transfer. And we already know that ME dot is zero. So this term comes to be zero. Now only left term is here MI dot HI. So but we have MI dot HI is equal to dm by dt of control volume. Let me apply that here.
So I am having du by dt of control volume is equal to,
I am applying dm by dt of control volume instead of MI dot since both are equal. Okay.
This is first equation, this is 2, now 2 in 1. So it will be dm by dt of control volume
into HI,
that was old value.
This is what we are having. Now we will see what is happening. Shall I rub this? This picture is with you, right? Let me name this equation as equation 3. Okay. Now, HI is constant, right? There is no dot here. So I can integrate this equation with respect to time. Integrating this equation with respect to time, it will yield
du of control volume is equal to dm of control volume into HI,
right? This I can write
u2 minus u1 of control volume is equal to m2 minus m1 into HI,
right? Shall we cancel anything here? Right, else you can write
u2 m2 minus u1 m1 is equal to m2 minus m1 into HI.
Right, now it is crystal clear that what are terms we can strike off. We already know that the mass m1 is zero. So this term is gone. Here also this term gone. So the left out thing will be u2 m2 is equal to m2 HI.
u2 m2 is equal to m2 HI.
Right? What is u2 for an ideal gas? The gas fluid involved in this process is ideal gas, right? We know that u2 is nothing but mcv T2. It is specific internal energy, so we don't have to apply m. So it will be CV T2, and both side M2 is coming, so I am striking off that also. So instead of U2 I can write CV T2, instead of HI I can write CP TI.
So it will be CV T2 is equal to CP TI,
right? CP TI. They are asking us to find what is T2.
So T2 is equal to CP by CV into TI.
What is CP by CI? CP by CV. CP by CV is gamma. So we will be getting
T2 is equal to gamma TI.
Gamma TI. What is it? Gamma TI. Same question is asked for one of the GATE examination in mechanical engineering paper. There the question was simple, but they were asking us to find what is the final temperature inside the tank. The question was like this. What is the final temperature inside the gas? And initial temperature they have already given us 300 degrees Celsius or something. And they were, in the option it was greater than 300, less than 300, equal to 300, and option D was something else. So what will be the answer? Is gamma greater than 1 or 2, less than 1? We all know that gamma is equal to 1.4, that is a normal value you take. So T2 is definitely greater than Ti, and Ti in that case it was 300 degrees Celsius. So we will be getting T2 greater than 300 degrees Celsius or greater than incoming fluid temperature. Is that clear? Okay.